Good morning, dear friends. Welcome to Daybreak. The psalmist in Psalm 9, verses 2 says, I'll praise you, Lord, with all my heart and declare all your wondrous deeds. Yes, dear friends, acknowledging his wonderful deeds, let's praise and worship him with the choir.
Set my spirit free, that I might worship thee. Set my spirit free, that I might praise thy name. Let all bondage go, let your deliverance flow. Set my spirit free to worship thee.
Just lift up our right hand and tell him, set me free.
Set my spirit free, that I might worship thee. Set my spirit free, that I might praise thy name. Let all bondage go, let your deliverance flow. Set my spirit free to worship thee.
We lift up both our hands as a form of surrender to our God. St. Paul tells us the offering of your bodies is your spiritual worship. When everything physical is offered to the Lord, we experience our spiritual nature being one with our God.
Set my spirit free, that I might worship thee. Set my spirit free, that I might praise thy name. Let all bondage go, let your deliverance flow. Set my spirit free to worship thee. Set my spirit free, that I might worship thee. Set my spirit free, that I might praise thy name.
Let all bondage,
let all bondage go, let your deliverance flow. Set my spirit free to worship thee.
Sure, today's praise and worship lifted our hearts towards heavenly experience. Let us now pay attention to today's message.
Good morning. I want to reflect with you this morning on Mary, the Mother of God, and our mother. You know, years ago, I had this unique privilege of visiting the Holy Land and standing in the middle of the present-day city of Nazareth is a mammoth basilica of the Annunciation, built around what is believed to be the dwelling of Mary, the home of Mary. In a grotto-like room at the heart of the basilica is a small inscription on the altar. For those of you that have visited the Holy Land and Nazareth, it reads in Latin, Verbum caro hic factum est. Here, the Word became flesh. Basically, here, God became a man. Then it is believed that the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary And the response that Mary gave to Angel Gabriel changed the world forever. Think about it with me this morning. Here is a young Jewish girl who devoutly goes to the synagogue in Nazareth, fervently recites the Psalms of David, and prays her prayers along with the other women of her town, learning her religion about simply abandoning herself over into the care of God. All of a sudden, one day when she's in prayer, all her prayers and all her faith is put to test. God sends the angel Gabriel. The angel Gabriel comes to her after greeting Mary, simply tells her, Mary, you have found favor with God and you are going to be a mother. You're going to bring forth into this world God's only begotten son. Mary's perturbed, no doubt about it. She's just a young maiden, remember? She's young. And she protests and says, how can that be? I'm not even married yet. I don't know a man. And the angel assures her, listen, this is God's plan. And in God's plan, you're going to conceive by the power of the Holy Spirit, not by the power of a man and his union with you. God is going to make this happen. Now for Mary, as much as she had all the faith in her life, this is still a mystery. But she does not protest. If it's God saying, and if it's God wanting, and if it's God's will for me, she says, let it be done unto me according to God's will. I'm not here to question. I'm wondering how, but if God says he knows how it's going to happen, he knows better. If God says it's going to happen, let it happen. If God wants this the way it is, I am not going to say no to God. I have an absolute yes. And Mary says, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to God's holy will. Everything about the world changes from then on. Mary's yes to God's request. Sometime back, I was reading a funny little story of a man on a terrible night, cold, blowing rain in a most frightful manner. The streets are all deserted, flooded. He wades through the water holding a broken umbrella with a shawl around him and a muffler on his head, goes to a little bakery, the only bakery in town, just as the baker is shutting its doors. And he tells him, listen, give me 2 buns to go. The baker looks at him and says, just 2 buns? And he says, yes, just that. 1 for me and 1 for Bernie, he says. So the baker looks at him, you come out in the middle of such a horrible night just to buy 2 buns? 1 for you and 1 for Bernie? And the man nods his head and says, yeah. So the baker says, who's this Bernie, by the way? Your wife? And the man says, what in the world are you thinking? Would my mother ever send me out on a night like this to buy 2 buns? Of course it's my wife. Funny as it is, there's a truth behind it. We have a mother who said yes to God, took up the challenge of being the mother of the Savior, bringing forth into this world Jesus for all of us. A mother who signed up to experience the mystery of God's salvific plan unfold in her life, in the life of her son Jesus, and in the life of the world. Because of her yes, Mary stood at the cross to behold the suffering and the death of her son. This mother who let her son suffer did so because she wouldn't want to let you and me suffer the pain of sin and the pain of eternal damnation. This is the mother that we have. This is the mother whose yes changed the course of history in our world. and the history of our own personal lives. Today, I invite you to think about Mary, to think about her yes to God's eternal plan for us. Are you ready to say yes to God when God calls you? What would God be calling you to do today? What would God be requesting you? What would God ask of you? What favor would God seek? As you and I think about it for the rest of today, let us stop to also wonder about what our response would be. When God asks for a favor from you, would you say yes, just like Mary, even if it's a mystery, even if it's the unknown, knowing well that God knows it all and that God is the author of our life? Wish you all a blessed day with Mary, our loving mother, loving you dearly, caring for you, pleading with God for you, and staying by your side to make sure that you experience the fullness of salvation that her son Jesus brought to this world. God bless you. Have a great day.
Certainly, today's message has given us new insights for reflection. Our church is blessed with many who led exemplary lives and became saints. Let us now look at the life of the saint the church venerates today.
Saint Pascal Baylon was a Franciscan lay brother and mystic. He performed miracles and was distinguished for his austerity. He is patron of Eucharistic associations. His parents, Martin and Elizabeth Baylon, were poor peasants. He was born in 1540 at Torre Hermosa in Aragon on the Feast of Pentecost, which in Spain was called the Pasch, or Passover, of the Holy Spirit. Hence he was christened Pascua, in honor of the feast. According to accounts of his early life, Saint Pascal labored as a shepherd for his father and would carry a book with him and beg passerbys to teach him the alphabet and to read. Eventually, he did teach himself to read, and as he toiled in the fields, he would read religious books. Receiving a vision which told him to enter a nearby Franciscan community, he became a Franciscan lay brother of the Alcatrine Reform in 1564 and spent most of his life as a humble doorkeeper. In around 1564, he joined the Reformed Franciscan Order as a lay brother. He chose to live in poor monasteries because, he said, "I was born poor and am resolved to die in poverty and penance." He lived a life of poverty and prayer, even praying while working, for the rest of his life. He practiced rigorous asceticism and displayed a deep love for the Blessed Sacrament, so much so that while on a mission to France, he defended the doctrine of the Real Presence against a Calvinist preacher, even in the face of threats from other irate Calvinists. He was a mystic and contemplative, and he had frequent ecstatic visions. He would spend the night before the altar in prayer many nights. At the same time, he sought to downplay any glory that might come from his piety. Pascal died on 17th of May, 1592, at a friary in Villarreal. He was beatified by Paul V in 1618 and canonized by Alexander VIII on 16th October, 1690. Pascal Baylon was enlisted in the Church's struggle against secularism, part of which was through increasing devotion towards the sacrament of the Eucharist. Pope Leo XIII proclaimed in 1897 Saint Pascal Baylon as the Seraph of the Eucharist, patron of Eucharistic congresses and all contemporary and future Eucharistic associations. Christian art usually depicts him wearing the Franciscan habit and bearing a monstrance, signifying his devotion to the Holy Eucharist, or in adoration before a vision of the Eucharist. His tomb in the Royal Chapel in Villarreal, in the old province of Valencia, where he died, immediately became an object of pilgrimage. We take time here to pause and look at the powerful presence of Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. In modern times, about the last 20 years, Eucharistic adoration has increased around the world, with the laity often organizing this prayer in the parish churches. Even the great basilicas in Rome have now enclosed silent adoration chapels where the devout may sit in prayer amidst the places where many pilgrims and tourists visit. The Catechism of the Catholic Church quotes St. John Paul II on the need for Eucharistic adoration. The Church and the world have a great need for Eucharistic worship. Jesus awaits us in the sacrament of love. Let us not refuse the time to go to meet him in adoration, in contemplation full of faith, and open to making amends for the serious offenses and crimes of the world. Let our adoration never cease. It is highly fitting that Christ should have wanted to remain present to his church in this unique way, since Christ was about to take his departure from his own in his visible form. He wanted to give us his sacramental presence. Since he was about to offer himself on the cross to save us, he wanted us to have the memorial of the love with which he loved us to the end, even to the giving of his life. In his Eucharistic presence, he remains mysteriously in our midst as the one who loved us and gave himself up for us, and he remains under signs that express and communicate this love. Even more famous than St. Paschal for his love for the Eucharist was St. Thomas Aquinas. He is believed to be the greatest theologian of the Church and wrote extensively on the Eucharist to help our faith. He said, "In this sacrament are the true body of Christ, and his true blood is something that cannot be apprehended by the senses, but only by faith, which relies on divine authority." St. Thomas's tender love for Jesus in this sacrament is expressed in his poetry and hymns, one being his Adoro Te Devote. Godhead here in hiding, whom I do adore, masked by these bare shadows, shape and nothing more. See, Lord, at thy service, low lies here a heart, lost, all lost in wonder at the God thou art. Seeing, touching, tasting, are in thee deceived. How, says trusty hearing, that shall be believed. What God's Son has told me, take for truth I do. Truth himself speaks truly, or there's nothing true. Let us pray. O Lord, who did give St. Paschal a love of prayer and such a devotion for your body and blood in the Eucharist, help us by his prayers to have a great respect, love, and honor for this sacrament, to always receive you in purity of heart. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us remember in our prayers today the deceased. O Christ, every tongue shall confess that you are Lord to the glory of God the Father. Welcome our brothers and sisters who have died into the unfailing joy of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
After looking at the life of this saint, are you not inspired to lead a holy life? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Yes, Lord, it is your word that gives us light in moments of troubles and darkness. Let us now listen to today's message.
Praise the Lord. Dear friends, welcome to the Daily Bread, a daily reflection on the Word of God. As we are in the month of May, a month dedicated to special honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary, we will be reflecting on Bible passages that somehow are related to the Blessed Virgin. Today we read from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. And in that region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy, which will come to all the people. For you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying which had been told them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary kept all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. This is the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dear friends, we are in the mood of Christmas in this rain. And it's due to Luke, who has pictured these beautiful scenes of the manger, of the angels, and of the shepherds, the singing of glory that we repeat every day in the church. And all these beautiful scenes are depicted by Luke in the infancy narrative. And what concerns us most is the picture of Mary. See, we have seen yesterday that they had to take refuge in a cave outside the town for the child to be born. And the child was laid in a manger because they did not get place in the inn. Totally abandoned, alone, rejected, as if it would seem. And now suddenly the heavens open and angels come down, singing glory and praising God. And this vision or apparition of the angels took place not to the people in the city, nor in the palaces or anywhere, but to shepherds who were watching their sheep out in the field at night. They were also outside the borders of the society, marginalized. Even though Abraham, the father of Israel, was a shepherd, and Moses, the leader, and David, the first king of Israel, were all shepherds, by the time of Jesus, shepherds had a very bad reputation and they were considered as impure people because of the stink of the sheep and also the possibility or the calumny that they were stealing sheep. So to these people who had been marginalized, set outside the city walls, the angels appear and heavens open above them. And note the emphasis, to you is born today, to you. So the Savior is born for you. So the emphasis on that, to you is born today. And I bring you the good news. So these people who had been abandoned and people who had been considered as impure, these are the chosen people to listen to the good news. And these are the people who had to go and spread the good news. To you is born today. And who is that? The Savior, who is Christ the Lord. So all the promises done through the prophets are now being fulfilled, and that fulfillment is being announced to the shepherds. And they sing glory to God in the highest, and to on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. The peace comes to those who receive God's favor, as Mary was favored. And the people who receive the favor most are the poor and the weak and the marginalized. And then the sign is given to them. They will find a child lying in a manger. Anybody is welcome. There is no royal guards keeping watch over this baby. Anybody is welcome. Only one thing, you have to bend down to enter the cave. And the shepherds are happy to go and meet. And see, exactly. And they went with a haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in manger. So Mary and Joseph become a channel of seeing Jesus. Jesus with Mary, and Mary comes first. And they reported. And one thing that the evangelist emphasizing is Mary kept all these things, pondering them in her heart. So that is a characteristic of the mother of Jesus. She did not understand everything. She did not question anything, but she kept everything in the heart, pondering over. It was a lifelong meditation on God's dealings, so strange, so unexpected. It was never told, never expected that the Messiah would be born in a manger, that there will be no room for the Messiah in the inn in Bethlehem. He is supposed to be the Son of God, Son of David, a royal child, having no place to be born. This is all strange. And Mary had a lot to ponder, a lot to meditate. And the whole life of Mary was characterized by this meditating on the Word of God. And that's also for us a great lesson. Maybe things happen in our lives that we don't understand. Totally unexpected things. Maybe the life takes turns that we never expected. But then God has a purpose for anything and everything that happens in our life. Only trust in Him. Trust in the divine providence and keep pondering, and God will give us the answer. As Mary found the answer, and the shepherds who came and saw went back praising God and spreading the good news. That should be also a model and example for us. Meditating on the Word of God and rejoicing and thanking God and praising Him for all the gifts, and also proclaiming, telling others what you have experienced. Your God encounter should not remain in your own heart. You should spread out. Go and proclaim the good news as the shepherds did. Now let us conclude with a prayer. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I'm sure today's Daily Bread has given you new insights to ponder over. As we come to the end of this episode of Daybreak, let us once again thank the Lord with this hymn.
Shout of the King.
The last half an hour has really been a blessing to you. Till we meet again, stay blessed.